called Truk, Lagoon.
Now, yesterday, the recovery of bones of the Japanese war debt from ships that went down a Truk, but today, the question, what to do with the remains? And here's Lee.
And whether they will get them all in the back. Something we did not expect when we got to Truk. On the maps of Truk Lagoon, you may find locations for many of the Japanese shipwrecks, but there is one wreck that is not listed on the maps, for it has been known, its location, only a short time. The key to its demise was Japanese military strategy, which lured American forces far out into the Pacific, hoping the U.S. Navy could not sustain the war effort so far from home. The Battle of Truk Lagoon was a key element in convincing them they were wrong.
Lost beneath the waters of Truk Lagoon since the end of World War II, the Japanese destroyer Oite has just recently been discovered. Few people know the Oite's location, miles away from the center of battle that erupted here in 1944, far from the other shipwrecks in the lagoon.
Okay, everything's on?
It's on.
Thank you.
Down the anchor line, stretched deeply into the warm water, 100 feet down, 150 feet, deeper still, a diver must travel until the hazy outlines of the crippled Japanese warship finally become visible. The Oite rests on a white sand bottom 220 feet beneath the surface. This is the first videotape ever taken of the lost destroyer, the first public view of her since she came crashing to the bottom, broken in two during that fierce battle. She lies so deep that a diver can remain here only about 10 minutes. The intense pressure threatening to inflict disorientation, injury, or even death. The Oite should never have been at Truk that day. She was scheduled to be refitted back in Japan and had left the lagoon for home just before the battle broke out. Even sunken to the bottom now, her big guns look imposing, but they were just as useless on her last day as they are now. All the Oite's shells and most of her anti-aircraft ammunition had been left on shore. She was an impotent warrior, yet her skipper obeyed orders and steered her back into the hailstorm of the American attack. Defenseless, she was sent to the bottom quickly, taking with her hundreds of men. During so many intervening years, the Oite and all the sunken ships of Truk Lagoon have been utterly transformed by the more powerful forces of nature. The plants and animals of the sea have taken possession of them as the ocean seeks to remake everything in its own image. Virtually every railing on this military transport ship is laden with thick clusters of sea life. Soft corals spread their color and delicate beauty over the drab steel. Life now abounds on the instruments of death. Nature has recovered and restored what was here long before the crashing violence of warfare temporarily interrupted its natural flow. And above the water's surface, just as surely has the land reclaimed the structures of war that never truly belonged here. Film shot by American Navy pilots recalls the withering assault on the Japanese fighter plane base on Truk's Etten Island, a long, wide concrete airfield home to scores of fighters, extended the full length of the island and became a central target. To the children of Etten Island, the war, of course, is not even a memory. It exists only in stories rarely told by their elders. It must be hard for the young Truckees to imagine, to believe that this thick and towering tropical forest where they live was once a busy wartime airbase, flat and treeless, covered with concrete and controlled by the Japanese, a people they now hardly know. Reminders are here, an occasional patch of broken concrete encountered in the shadows of coconut palms, reinforced bunkers too strong to weather down, so they are simply enveloped. Before the Japanese evacuated their headquarters here on Etten Island, they tried to destroy it so it would be of no use to the Americans. But they built it so strongly that neither their efforts nor the American bombs that blasted a few holes in the roof were able to destroy the structure completely. And so now, in the quiet of the jungle, more than 40 years after that enormous attack, the fighter pilots' headquarters provide shelter for a family of Truckees. 10 of them make their home here. Patriarch of the family, Tanyan Ko, is the only one here who remembers. Like so many Pacific Islanders, the Truckees were innocent bystanders in a war they did not cause and did not want. But the war did come, and in its final days, as Japanese defeat became a certainty and food became scarce, life became desperate and mean. The Truckees were pressed into forced labor. Malnutrition was rampant.
He clapped when the American came in, because when the Japanese died, it's very hard to they treat them like a slave. When they start running out of food, if you own a breadfruit tree, then if they saw you to climb up on your own tree, then they beat you with a stick or shoot you with a gun.
The breadfruit comes freely from the trees now. Oppression departed with the defeated Japanese, but so did the island's entire economic base. Many Truckees today still live on whatever they can harvest from the jungle or from the waters of the lagoon. Truk eventually became a trust territory of the United States, but the U.S. government did little to help the islands recover their self-sufficiency. Still today, they have only one cash crop, one thing to sell to the rest of the world: copra, dried coconut, which is processed into vegetable oil. Last year, Tanyan Ko made copra every day and sold it to exporters for 20 cents a pound, enough for him to buy the few things his family needs. But this year, a worldwide glut of vegetable oil sent copra value plummeting to just 3 cents per pound, too low to make the work worthwhile. Most of their crop now falls from the trees and rots on the ground.
You know, when we want to eat copra, we get the copra.
But
if we don't, we just
Throw it away.
Throw it away.
But that was your cash crop. That was how you made money.
Yeah.
What does it feel like to throw all that away now?
Nothing.
No good?
What may appear to an outsider to be an idyllic life is not at all that without enough money for food supplements, medical care, and the other necessities of life. It is an irony of history that once again now, Truk's fate is tied to the Japanese. This time, not to their ships and fighter planes, but to their tourists. 5 times a week, jet loads of Japanese visitors fly in from Guam, and the money they spend has become very important to Truk's economy. Many of the Japanese are drawn here by the wartime history. They come to honor their dead, who still lie aboard sunken ships. Those submerged relics of war also attract scuba divers from around the world. To them, Truk is an adventure. To the Japanese, it is a shrine. All of the ships and everything on them are protected by law as a National Historic Monument. But the Japanese are profoundly troubled by the mere presence of sport divers amidst their relatives' graves. To them, the very idea of curious hands touching the skull of a loved one is anathema. It is desecration. Although more than 400 of the skeletons have been removed and returned to Japan, 1,300 are unrecovered.
Now the Oite has been discovered. A number of requests to remove the remains have been made to the Japanese government by the families of the dead of the Oite.
The families would like...
So far, some families have visited Truk twice in memory of their lost ones on the Oite.
But when a Japanese delegation formally appealed to Truk's governor, Erhard Eaton, for permission to recover all the remains from the lagoon, his reply was blunt.
The people of Truk Island regard the bones as ours. As long as the bones are here, Japanese will come and visit the island. If all the bones are gone, Japanese will no longer come here.
Perhaps it seems cold-hearted to hold bones hostage for tourist dollars, but the Truckees remember the pain inflicted upon them 4 decades ago. They also know that Japanese tourism today is crucial to their fragile economy. Japan's post-war reconciliation with Truk may be almost complete, but this beautiful place in the Western Pacific is likely to remain for them a wound of war which will not heal.
It is hard to say yet with any certainty whether the Japanese will be allowed back to recover more of the remains. Although Japanese families of the dead have made their requests to Truk officials, no formal request has yet been made by the Japanese government.
That request is due when?
I would expect it probably this year or next, I think.
Okay. We're going to take a quick break, and when we return, we'll continue with Lee's discoveries at Truk, focusing on the American veterans of the Pacific War and how they remember Truk Lagoon.